Greetings to all of you. This is Pastor Brian Cash here at the East Mount Zion Baptist Church, and I am so thankful that you have decided to tune in to our weekly scheduled streaming of worship. We understand that we are still limited with the precautions of COVID-19, and we pray that you are staying home, staying safe. Despite all of the things that are going on, I want you to stay home and stay safe. We are praying for you. We're praying with you. Today is our Available Sunday. Available Sunday, you may ask, what is that? Available Sunday simply means that our Lifeline Ministry, the ministry that has been serving the community for so many years, providing food, fresh produce, fresh meat to people in our community, they are still doing that even during this season. And so I wanted to celebrate them and show that East Mount Zion Baptist Church is still being available. And so we decided to let worship meet work. Yes. And so that's what we're doing today. I'm dressed down today. The sermon is provided to you through our service and our church today. All of us, all of our deacons, all of our leaders are dressed down because we are working and serving today. We served over 240 people today, and it was an amazing piece. So I pray that you join in to this message. Hear this message about availability. Hear the songs about availability. Hear the prayers and the preaching about availability, because we want you to know that God has called us to be available to the unavailable. Remember to stay connected to our church. I pray that something is said throughout this service and something is done throughout these moments of streaming that blesses your life and causes you to be closer to God. Remember, we love you. We're praying for you, and may the Lord bless you. Enjoy the worship.
Good morning. My name is Deacon Bobby McDowell of East Mount Zion Baptist Church. We welcome you as part of this morning service. We are happy to be of service to the community. I welcome also the deacon from Antioch Baptist Church.
Thank you. I'm John Addison, deacon at Antioch Baptist Church, and we're just honored to be able to participate in this with you, to be able to help serve the community and follow what Christ says, do unto others as we would have them do unto you, unto us. All the laws and prophets are based on this. And if we were hungry, we would like someone who would extend themselves to help feed us.
Amen. Amen. East Mount Zion Baptist Church and Antioch Baptist Church will join together in this devotional moment.
Throw out the lifeline. Throw out the lifeline. Someone is drifting away. Throw out the lifeline. Throw out the lifeline. Someone is drifting away.
was hungered, and ye gave me meat. I was thirsty, and ye gave me drink. I was a stranger, and ye took me in. Naked, and ye clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came unto me. And the king shall answer and say unto them, Verily I say unto you, as much as ye have done it unto one of the least of these, my brethren, ye have done it unto me. Matthew 25, 35, 36, 40.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It's Deacon Derek Dixon from Antioch Baptist Church, and we invite all of us in physical attendance and those of you watching along with us to join us as we go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this very day. We thank you for these lives, Father, that have come together in your name to do your will. Father, we thank you, Lord, that the vineyard is ripe with those who are in need, and Father, who have heard the gospel message or should be open to the gospel message, Father, that includes tangibly taking care of the needs of those who have need, Father. So, Father, we just thank you for each and every minister, each and every deacon, each and every family that is represented here to provide the basic life sustenance for those, Father, who need it the most. In these times, Lord, where needs are magnified all over the world, Father, you have called us to be a city set on a hill. You've called us to be salt and light in the earth, Lord, and we want to fulfill that mission in your name. And not just to take care of physical needs, Father, but to make it a part of the bigger spiritual need that we all have. We know, Lord, that sin had left a crimson stain, but Father, the finished work and the shed blood of Jesus have washed it white as snow. So thank you for this opportunity, Father. May all those who receive be blessed, and let those also be blessed who participate to do the kingdom work. We count it a privilege, and we thank you for it all. In Jesus Christ's name, amen.
Amen. I am on the battlefield for my Lord. I am on the battlefield for my Lord. And I promised him that I would serve him till I die. And I promise.
And I just want to give a big thank you, man, to all of our volunteers. There are many volunteers in this program, many of them that never see this part of it, but they work on the administrative side of it. And we're all dedicated and making ourselves available to Christ through this Lifeline program by doing what the Lord says, feeding those who are less fortunate. And we give it a big praise from our founder from over 40 years ago, who would say, thanks a million.
Amen.
All right, brothers and sisters, good job. Good job.
Good morning. I am Mildred Coates, currently serving as the Lifeline Coordinator for our East Mount Zion Food Pantry. We are so happy to be here or have you here with us on our distribution Saturday. We've spent the previous 4 days of this week and days earlier this month with call-ins, and now we're down to our distribution Saturday, where we have been serving through our curbside pickup, 100 families coming in that direction, and our delivery, which services about 140 to 50 families. Our program is ongoing every month. We have a process that we utilize, which is a call-in system. And if you call 231-0284, you will hear the necessary information about the time and the dates for each month to call in. This program has been in operation for over 40 years. I am ecstatic and pleased to be a part of it and to have been a part of it for the past 20 years. We have at least 35 plus volunteers who are currently working with us right now. We look forward to each month being in a position to make ourselves available to those who make the necessary requests by phone because of the need that they have at the current time in their lives. We want you to continue as our East Mount Zion family, as well as our partnering agencies, Hunger Network and the Food Bank, keep supporting us and lifting us up in prayer. East Mount Zion has been generous and very supportive through the years to the success of this program. We continue to serve and we'll continue to make ourselves available if the need is there, whenever. I thank you. Thank you. As our founder of the program would always say, thanks a million. It's Available Sunday.
Today is Available Sunday. Available Sunday simply means that East Mount Zion Baptist Church has submitted ourselves to the call of being available to those who ideally are forgotten about. And the Lifeline Ministry has done that. East Mount Zion Baptist Church Lifeline Ministry has done service in our community for so many years. And you've seen some of the service that they've done. And today we have constructed a worship service around what it means to be available. I don't have a suit on today. We are here in our sanctuary because today is not about us. It's not about what we have on, but it's about service. And you have been supporting East Mount Zion Baptist Church even through this COVID experience. And I want to say thank you. I want to thank all of our members, everyone who continued to give, everyone who continues to donate and support our church. I want to offer this opportunity now to every person who's watching this broadcast, watching this live stream, to be able to give and share to the East Mount Zion Baptist Church family. You have options on the screen right now, EMZBC, to text that to 77977. And you'll be able to share a gift not only to our church, but also you can share to our Lifeline Ministry. Today we served over 240 people and continue to serve during the COVID-19 experience. Our leader, I asked before COVID-19 happened, I asked her, Miss Mildred Coates and Deacon Booth, are we still going to be able to serve? And she said, absolutely, yes. Matter of fact, someone called yesterday to the church and asked, when is Lifeline going to start again? And our administrative church secretary said, Lifeline has never stopped because we do not stop serving, although there are limitations around us.
And so I'm sharing to you the opportunity that you can continue to share and give to our church as we continue to give to our community. Because we believe by faith the Lord has called us to be of service and to be available to others. Remember, brothers and sisters, that we are still here not only being available through serving food, but we are still here being available to you, all of our seniors. We want to make sure that you have filled out your census and you have done your voter registration, because we want to make sure that those resources that have been allocated to America and different counties are allocated to the Black community. So make sure that you fill out your census and make sure you fill out your voter registration. Continue to pray, continue to be available to someone else. I'm challenging everyone who's watching this broadcast today to be available to one person each and every day. Matter of fact, I'm challenging you today. Call someone, call a senior, call someone and check on them. Be available to someone. Now, I want you to now be available to our guest soloist today, the maestro, Mr. Brackens, Mr. Glenn Brackens, who's going to bless us in a tremendous way. Continue to stay connected to our church on Facebook and so many other different ways and our website. And we want you to continue to be connected to East Mount Zion Baptist Church. Enjoy the service. Thank you. in prayer. God, our Father, we are grateful for your grace. We're grateful for your mercy. We're grateful for your kindness. It is only because of you that we live and have our being. And so, God, we trust you in every way. We pray, Father, that you will forgive us for all of our sins and all of our transgressions. Everything that we've committed against you that caused us to be disconnected from you. For Lord, we know that you're the source of our life, and we need to remain in you so that you remain in us. God, we pray that you would prepare our hearts and mind to receive a word from you. Because, Father, we need a word from you. We need a word from you like we've never needed a word before. In these days of COVID, social distancing, Lord, we need to hear your word, feel your word, and experience your word. So now, Father, clear our mind from all distractions so that we can receive a word from you. Lord, touch my mind and hold it steady. Touch my tongue and speak for you. Lord, decrease me and increase yourself at this moment. God, this is your moment. This is not my moment. And so, Lord, we pray that you would be with us, even though we are not together, you would be with us all at the same time because you are omnipresent. We trust in your power. We trust in your ability. It's in your name that we pray. Amen. I want to thank all of you again for continuing to support our church here at East Mount Zion Baptist Church. Again, this is our Available Sunday. We have highlighted the work of the ministry of the Lifeline as they continue to work and serve in the community. And so this service is centered around availability, and there is a word that we have been sharing for the past 3 weeks since Easter, available. And what does it mean for the church to be available to not only ourselves, but the church to be available to God and the church to be available to others? And so we've been preaching from resurrection until now, this Easter season. And we shared last Sunday that Easter is not a one event, but it's a season that speaks to availability. And so let's continue this conversation of availability in John chapter number 20. We shared last week the story of the disciples headed to Emmaus. And so today we will share the story of Thomas. That character we identify as doubting Thomas. John chapter 20, verse 24, says these words from the NIV version. Now Thomas, also known as Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands, and put my finger where the nails were, and put my hands into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them, though the doors were locked. Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands, reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen me yet believe." I want to share this morning on this particular subject, available to the unavailable. Available to the unavailable. The story of resurrection and the story of Thomas is a story of availability. We shared last week that when Jesus got up from the grave, he thought it not robbery to become available to those who needed him the most. At Easter season, or Easter was not just one day, but it is a season because Jesus knew there were people he needed to see and to help people who still needed him because they were struggling with Calvary. And so we shared last week that Jesus goes to meet these people. He goes to meet Mary and the women because he knows they're struggling. He goes to meet these disciples, these two disciples headed to Emmaus with their heads held down because he knew they were struggling. I shared with you last week, God has a way of meeting us just where we are. There's this amazing story that appears only in the Gospel of John. John chapter 20, verse 24, of a story of a disciple called Thomas. You know Thomas, this same Thomas that said to Jesus in John chapter 11, when Jesus said, we have to go and to Bethany because Lazarus has died. And the disciples said, Jesus, you can't go to Bethany. They're trying to stone you in Jerusalem. And Thomas says, Jesus will go with you even if it requires us to die. The same Thomas that said to Jesus, when Jesus says, I go away to prepare a place, Thomas said, wait a minute, Jesus, where do you mean? What do you mean you're going away? Where are you going and how do we find or go with you? This same Thomas. The scripture says, when the disciples are locked in a room, Thomas is not there. Jesus comes to meet the disciples as they are locked away in the room, and he invites them to see his holds and see his hands and see his sides. And he shares with them, peace be with you. And the scripture says Thomas was unavailable. I believe, brothers and sisters, this story of Thomas being unavailable speaks to a greater narrative of unavailable people who were not and did not have access to the very things that others have access to. Thomas is unavailable. We don't know why Thomas is not at the party. We don't know why Thomas is not with the disciples, but we do know Thomas is by himself dealing with the emotions of Calvary all by himself. While the disciples have a collection of people together to deal with it with each other, while they are wrestling with Calvary as a group, Thomas is wrestling with the trauma of Calvary by himself. Thomas represents the unavailable crew. But I love Jesus because Jesus shows up 8 days later. Although Thomas was not there 8 days before, Jesus shows up to remind us that God is still available to people who have been unavailable to him. And it does not matter how you have been disconnected from him. But the Lord reminds us that I'm not concerned about where you were when I came first, but I'm going to still be available to you no matter how much you've been disconnected from me. And I've come to suggest to you, children of God, that we live in a world filled with a lot of unavailable people, people who are suffering on their own, people who are disconnected from the resources that others have. But I love Jesus because Jesus says that's who you're supposed to be available to. You're not supposed to ask where you were, why weren't you here, why weren't you available to the time that I had come to you. No, Jesus asked Thomas none of this. And this story of Thomas shows the church that we are called to be available to the unavailable. And that's why we have Available Sunday, because this Sunday is about East Mount Zion saying to ourselves that we are not called to just be available to people that come to church every Sunday. No, no, we are not called to be available to people that wear nice clothes and have it all together and are at the right places at the right time to experience Jesus. No, we are called to meet those people who are unavailable, people who are suffering on their own, people who are dealing with trauma of life on their own. That's what Jesus calls us to do, and that's what Jesus does in the story of Thomas. He goes calls to meet not just the disciples, but he calls to meet a person who identifies with the unavailable crew. And you may be looking at me like I'm sideways or you don't understand what I'm saying, but all of us have been a part of that unavailable crew. All of us have had to deal with trauma and life on our own. All of us have been in the place where we didn't have the right speech and weren't in the right places at the right time or doing the right things at the right time. But God came and met us and said, I do not care where you were. I'm coming to share to you that I'm available to you no matter how much you've been unavailable to me. And so the scripture today shares to us a beautiful story about how our Christ not only meets us where we are, but he meets us even when we've been unavailable to him. And then this scripture, I want to unpack this John chapter 20, verses 24 through 28, about how our God is available to the unavailable, that provides us this image of how we are called to be available to the unavailable. Let's look at the scriptures today and feel our charge and how we're supposed to be available to the unavailable. What does Jesus do? The first thing we know that Christ is available to the unavailable is, number one, Jesus never forgets us. I want you to say that. Jesus never forgets us. I love this. The scripture says that Thomas was not there. The disciples had gathered around, and the first thing when Thomas gets to the crowd or gets around his disciple friends, they say, we have seen the Lord. It is an indictment that you were not here. We received resources and something from God that you did not receive. We saw the Lord. We touched his hands and we touched his side. We experienced something that you did not experience because you were not here. Can I submit to you, children of God, one of the worst feelings in the world is the feeling of being forgotten about. And I don't know if Thomas is dealing with this, but this speaks to this greater narrative of the word forgotten. I never forget hearing the story of my grandfather who worked at Ford Motor Company for years. And my grandfather sat me down and told me the story of how he was forgotten about. He said, I worked on the assembly line. He said, as I worked on the assembly line, I told the boss about something that would help us be more efficient. And as a result of inventing something, creating something that would help Ford Motor Company, the boss said, when promotion time comes around, I have your name written down. My grandfather said he was happy and went and worked back on that line, but when promotion time came around, the job was given to a white young man who had just got on the job. My grandfather, with tears in his eyes, talked about the emotion of being forgotten. Can I submit to you something, children of God? That raw emotion is not anything easy to deal with, because there is something about those who are unavailable, who have been forgotten about, who others have received the resources and access to opportunities, but there is a group of people who have been forgotten about. It reminds me of us who have been kissed by the ebony hue sun, us black folk who have been always forgotten about. When the saying is when America catches a cold, black folk catch pneumonia. And it speaks to this whole reality of how black people have been forgotten about. 400 years of free labor and experiencing everything and doing everything to create and establish for a whole country that keeps on forgetting about you. There is this phrase called the fourth grade syndrome. that teaches teachers to forget about certain students while giving all of the resources to other students. There is a raw emotion about being forgotten. About some of you have experienced that feeling of being forgotten while others receive certain resources and others receive certain attention and others experience certain things that you did not experience. You remember that raw emotion of being the unavailable, forgotten about. But I love what Jesus does. Jesus shows us that he does not forget about the unavailable because he shows up 8 days later. And I love this. When he shows up, he does the same thing he did 8 days prior. Look at the scripture. 8 days prior, the Bible says, while the disciples were gathered, he walks in the door. And when he walks through the door, a locked door, he says, "Peace be unto you." And then he tells the disciples, "Touch my hands and touch my side." He gives them reassurance that he's alive. But notice the same thing he does 8 days later. He walks through a locked door. He says, "Peace be unto you." And he says, "Thomas, touch my hand and touch my side." Only to remind us that the same resources that I gave to them, I ain't forgot about you, Thomas. I'm going to give you the same thing about you. I know others have forgotten about you. I know others have resources that you have. I know some schools have better resources than the schools that your children and your parishioners' children go to. But the good news is I'm still available to you. And the reason I know he's available to me is because the stuff others forgot to give me, or the stuff others forgot to share with me, God always provides for me. Why? Because he owns the cattle on the thousand hills, and whatever God has, he gives to me. You can forget about me. You can abandon me. You can leave me all alone, but I'm grateful that I serve a God that says he never forgets me. He always has me on his mind. And you know the beauty of God having us on his mind? It means that God has all of us on his mind at the same time. And he's omnipresent, meaning he can be at all places. And not only is he omnipresent, but he's omniscient, meaning he's all powerful and all knowing, omnipotent and omniscient. And I love that, meaning that the God who has me on his mind, he's all powerful, he's all knowing, and he's everywhere at the same time. So because he got me on his mind, he can care for me and you at the same time in ways nobody else can. Thomas, I love this story. I love this story because it shows us that although he was forgotten about others, although he was not available at the time the other disciples got together, Jesus says, "Thomas, I ain't forgot about you. You still my brother. You still my child." And that's what God says to us, children of God. God shares to us, and you are called to be available to others. You are called not to be a person that forgets about the unavailable, forgets about the homeless, forgets about the sick, forget about the people who are in the hospital, stuck in their bedrooms, and no one is there to call them. No, it is your job to call them. It is your job to remember them. Why? Because he remembered you. He remembered you when you were on drugs. He remembered you when you were sick. He didn't forget about you when you were hungry. He didn't forget about you when you had that child out of marriage and everyone turned their back on you and everyone looked down on you. God said, "Child, I ain't forgot about you, but I still got you on my mind." Can you shout in your living room that the Lord didn't forget about you, that the Lord still had you on your mind, on his mind, when your parents turned their back on you, when your friends turned their back on you? God said, the same stuff that I gave to them, the same way I bless others, I'll bless you. We say this every time we end the living room testimonials. There is no secret. What God can do, what he's done for others, what he's done for them, what he's done for himself, he'll do the same thing for you. He doesn't forget about us. That's how I know he's still available to the unavailable. But then I love this piece. Not only does he not forget about us, but then second of all, I know he's available to the unavailable because Jesus grants us freedom from the control of worry. I like that. He grants us freedom from the control of worry. Jesus says, peace be with you. Now notice something. He walks in the door and he says, peace be with you. Locked door, walks in the door and says, peace be with you. What's ironic is few verses later, earlier when the disciples were together, he walks in the door and says the same thing. Peace be unto you. I wondered, why did Jesus say the same thing again? Someone may say he was just talking to Thomas. No, he was talking to all of them. Peace be unto you. It's a whole group of men in the room, and they are behind a locked door. Same locked door they were behind 8 days earlier. He walks through and says, peace be unto you. And 8 days later, they are still behind a locked door. And he walks through the locked door and says, peace be unto you. What a strange thing. You already said that 8 days earlier, Jesus. Why do you say peace be unto you again 8 days later to the same people you said it to before? The key answer is in the word peace be unto you. That word peace literally means freedom from the control of worry. It is the Greek word irene, which means literally you can have chaos around you and not be controlled by the chaos because you are unbothered and not worrying because you have peace all around you. It's the same word he uses on the storm when he says, peace be still. That there is a storm going around, but because Jesus is now in the room, he grants you peace. I like that because the scripture says he grants them this same peace 8 days earlier and then does it 8 days later. I wondered why Jesus waited 8 days later to come and to greet Thomas and the rest of the disciples. If you knew the letter eight means peace. It means tranquility. It means the absence of worry. In other words, what Jesus says is I'm showing up 8 days later because I know you still need this same peace. You locked behind a locked door. You still got the bolts on the door. You still got the screen door behind the door. You locked behind the door like you were 8 days ago. So I'm going to show up 8 days later, walk through the locked door and tell you, you won't have to worry about this anymore because I'm here. I love this because when the Lord shows up in our lives and he becomes available to us who have been unavailable to him, or we are called to be available to those who are unavailable, the message is this, is that God is offering us a peace that allows us to no longer be controlled by the worry that's created by our problems, but allows us to walk out of our locked doors and say to God, God, I know you got my back, and I know my purpose is on the other side of the locked door, and no longer will I stay in this room because you are giving me peace. I know many of us that fits for us because we are stuck at home and we are locked behind our doors, and we are in fear trying to figure out what's going to happen next. But God walks through our locked doors. He says, child, I'm not going to knock on your door. I'm not going to pick the lock. No, I'm going to walk right through your locked door and remind you, you ain't got no reason to worry, and you don't have any reason to fret, because I'm the one that provides you peace. And that's the word you ought to give to someone else, that word that tells them you don't have to stay locked behind the doors of life. You don't have to stay locked behind the fears of life. You don't have to stay locked behind anything. You need to come from behind that locked door, because he's granting you peace. Peace that says that I don't have to be controlled by my worry. I don't have to be controlled by my fears. I don't have to be controlled by the very things that control me. Although it's still existing, although my problems still are there, although the issues still are there, although the financial problems are still there, although COVID-19 ain't gone away, God grants us peace. That's how you can still work. That's how, if you're a business owner, your business can still go forward. That's how, if you still go into the hospital working as a first responder, you don't have to live in fear, because he grants you peace. Walk out tomorrow and go to your job. When they open up, walk outside. Be precautious. Do what you need to do, but don't live in fear, and don't live behind the locked doors of life, and know that God grants you this same peace. And this is the peace that we give to the unavailable, those who we serve. We remind them, you don't have to fear, you don't have to worry, because the God of all peace, the God of all love, the God of all grace is the God that keeps us when we cannot keep ourselves. Have you ever felt that peace? Have you ever been rocked with that peace? Have you ever woke up in the middle of the night and found that peace? Have you ever gone to bed, sleep, worrying about something, and you woke up and the Lord just gave you that peace? You know what that is? That's God walking through the locked door of your life, saying, child, stop worrying, stop fretting, stop being controlled by that, and know that I got you. Know that everything is going to be all right. God gives us peace. He gives us the freedom. I need that freedom. He gives us the freedom from the control of worry. But not only does he give us freedom from the control of worry, not only does he not forget about us, then I love this last piece. He invites us to experience a life-altering experience. He invites us to encounter a life-altering experience. I love this. Jesus walks up to Thomas. Listen to what he says in verse number 27. Thomas, put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting. Thomas says, my Lord and my God. I love this. Put your finger here, but see my hands. This request of Jesus is a strange request, because Jesus says to Thomas, put your finger here, but see my eyes. St. Augustine asked the question, was Jesus saying that Thomas had eyes on his fingers? That doesn't make any sense. Put your finger here and see. No. This is what Jesus was actually suggesting. Jesus was trying to get Thomas not to see with his physical eyes, but have an experience where he learns to see with all of his senses. Talking to my fiance on FaceTime, and she was saying how long her day was, telling me it was so very long. And I told her in response, didn't think what I said, but I said, I know I can see. And she said to me with sarcastic but very frustrated eyes, what do you mean you can see? You know, you never tell a person, especially your counterpart, if they tell you they had a long day, you can see, because that's not a good look. But what I said to her is, that's not what I meant. What I mean is, I can feel and experience your day. As you talk about it, I can see you walking through the halls, and I can experience everything that is associated with what is coming out of your mouth. That's what Jesus is saying to Thomas. Do not just see me with your eyes, but experience me. It's kind of like one of my best friend's mother. His mother is blind. But his mother used to say, it's good to see all of you. And I used to try to figure out, what does she mean is good to see all of us and she's blind? And I didn't understand that until now. And I read up on what it means to see with all senses. And researchers suggest that persons who cannot see with their physical eyes can see even better with all of the rest of their senses. And so what she was actually saying is, I can see you better than you can see me. I can sense your emotions, and I can sense everything that's connected to you. And that's what Jesus was trying to get Thomas to see, because Thomas was only seeing with his physical eyes. But if he could only get Thomas to see with his emotions, his senses, his smell, and everything else, he would be able to see that the Christ who was crucified on the cross is the Christ that's standing right in front of him right now. And I love this, because that's what God does to us. God says, do not just see me with your eyes. And even later on in verse 29, he says, blessed are those who do not see me and believe. He was actually talking about us, because we can't see God with our eyes, but we can see him with our hands. We can feel him in our souls. It's something to experience God's presence and cannot see God. An atheist would say, how do you believe in a God you cannot see? But I come to tell you, I believe in air and I can't see air. I believe in wind, but I can't see wind. But I can see the force of the wind. I can see the force of the air. And that's what God does in our lives. God invites us to have an experience with him that changes our whole mind, changes our whole soul. Have you ever had an experience with God and you began to see things you've never seen before? That's what God does in our lives. And that's what God invites Thomas to do. When God is available to the unavailable, he shows up in their lives and he invites them to experience him in ways they have never experienced him before. And listen what Thomas says in verse 28. Thomas says, my Lord and my God. It's a unique response, because Thomas uses two words for God. He uses Lord and he uses God. I was trying to figure out, why did Thomas use Lord and God? Lord, he uses kurios, and then God, he uses theos. Kurios means owner. It means Lord over life. It means master. Theos means the only God. Theos was given to the Greek god Zeus, because there were other gods. There was the sun god. There was the rain god. There was the moon god. But Zeus was attributed to theos, because he was the only God. But I've come to tell you, Zeus ain't theos. My God is the only God. He's the only God that reigns. And that's what Thomas was saying. I experienced you in a way that I saw you from a perspective I've never seen you before. And the only thing I could say is that you are the only God, and because you are the only God, I'm letting you know I belong to you. You are my owner. I am a part of you. In other words, this was what Thomas was saying. Thomas was saying, I don't have a reason to doubt anymore because I belong to the only God who owns me and controls my life and gives me exactly what I need. Can I ask you a question as I end this sermon? Have you ever experienced God in such a way that it recognized in your soul that he's the only God that can treat you like you are treated? He's the only God that can pick you up like you've been picked up before. He's the only God that can heal your body, and you're not worried. You're not worried. You're not doubting. You're not living in fear, because I belong to the true God. God calls us to have a life-altering experience with him that alters our mind and alters our soul and causes us to come to the recognition that I have no reason to fear, nor do I have any reason to doubt, nor do I have any reason to be worried, because I belong to the only true God. We used to sing that song, I belong to God, I belong to God. It's something to belong to a God that knows how to heal when you're sick. It's something to belong to a God that knows how to give you power when you're powerless. It's something to belong to a God, even when Trump says stupid stuff like infected, putting infection in your body, disinfection in your body. God says you ain't got to worry about trying to figure out new solutions. All you got to do is trust in me. Is there anybody at home today that can trust in God and knows that he's available to me because he's my God and he's my Lord? Somebody got that testimony today. Somebody has that affirmation today, and you don't live in fear, and you're coming from behind locked doors of life, and because you know that the God who is your only God does not forget you, does not forsake you, does not leave you all by yourself. I can get happy off of that in this sanctuary right now all by myself, because I thank God for the moments that he did not look over me, but he invited me to have an experience with him that changed my life, changed my walk, changed my mind. And I'm thankful today that God is the same God that gives me power and causes me to have an experience with him, changes my whole outlook on him. Before Thomas had this experience with Jesus, Thomas thought he was just an ordinary savior. Now that he had this experience with him, his life was ultimately changed. And so, brothers and sisters, I now invite you to have that experience with God. Have that encounter with God. God is saying, you've been unavailable to me, but I'm coming, walking through your locked doors to find you, to meet you, because I've never forgotten about you. I've never left you by yourself. But I'm here to offer you freedom from the control of worry. And I'm here to invite you to experience something you've never experienced before. You thought you experienced thrills like stuff you've experienced before, but you've never experienced a thrill like Christ. You thought you've seen things before, but you've never seen anything like my Christ. And so right now, brothers and sisters, I invite you to join in the family of God and experience a life-altering experience that makes you cry when nothing is sad. It makes you laugh when nothing is funny. It makes you run when no one is behind you. I invite you to experience that God. I offer you Christ right now. If you do not have a relationship with him, if you have not met him nor encountered him, I invite you to have that encounter. I invite you now to meet him, know him in the free pardon of your sins. If you are watching this broadcast and you don't have a relationship with Christ, I now offer Christ to you. If you are watching this live stream and you want to give your life to Christ, I want you to type in the comments, new Christian. If you are a guest of our church today, I want you to type in the comments, guest. And you want to become a part of East Mount Zion Baptist Church family. If you want to become a part of East Mount Zion Baptist Church family, I invite you now. If you could join in off of Christian experience, let us know. Call our church. The number is on the screen. If something is said or done through this service that touches your heart, if you need prayer, you need someone to pray for you, call the church. Because we are availing ourselves to those who have been forgotten about, those who have been unavailable. This is our available Sunday. We thank God that God is always available to us. We commit ourselves to being available to him. Let me pray with you. Father God, I pray in the name of Jesus that you would bless those who are watching this live stream, those who are watching this replay, those, oh God, whose heart have been touched by your word, heart have been touched by your message, hearts have been touched by this experience. I pray that they will see you in new ways. I pray that they will encounter you in ways they've never encountered you before. God, we give you praise for what you're going to do in and through their lives. I pray, oh God, for that new person that wants to give their life to you, that you would touch them in ways they need to be touched. Remind them that you are in control and that you're God and Lord over their lives. I pray they will come to the testimony like Thomas, my Lord and my God. God, we give you praise. We give you glory. In your name we pray, amen. If you're committed your life to Christ, I want you to pray with me. Lord, come into my heart. Forgive me of all of my sins and allow me to live a life like you've called me to live. You prayed that prayer, brothers and sisters, you're saved. And we want you to become a part of East Mount Zion Baptist Church family. Join us as we build the kingdom of God, cultivating faith, one day, one conversation, one life at a time. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May his face ever shine upon you. May he lift up his peace and give you joy. In his name we pray. Amen. Thank you.